in a bit we're going to be baptizing Alex. Where's Alex? Alex. Woo! So excited. Where are you from, Alex?
Roseville, Minnesota.
Minnesota, okay, well, it's going to be good. Ago, I went on vacation in Europe, south of France, and we were in a place, I don't know how good the geography is, between France and Switzerland, big mountains, the Alps, there's this beautiful lake, Lake Annecy, and I decided to go out with my friends in one of those pedalo boats. Just raise your hand if you've ever been out in one of those pedalo boats before. Okay, keep your hand up if it's the most exciting thing that you ever did in your life. No, just one. It was in fact the most... You were on the same lake. You know that. So here's what happens. You think, okay, this is gonna be really good fun. I'm gonna get into a primary colored plastic toy and pedal around on the water. It's gonna be the most fun ever. But after about 15 minutes, you're really tired and you're wet and it's just not fun. And you realize I've gotta do another 15 minutes of this. This is hell, but I paid for it. And so inevitably you start attacking other boats and like a water fight breaks out. In the UK we're big on naval battles, you know, and then we ended up diving into the water fully clothed and doing the old Jaws impression, dun, 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 and all the Swiss French people are standing around the bank yodeling and mending their watches and making chocolate and looking shocked. And then time's up, we swim ashore pulling our pedalo boats behind us, and we realized we had to do that thing which we're all going to have to do later today. We're going to have to get changed in our dry clothes in public, and you get taught to do it when you're little, don't you? You wrap the towel around you, you drop your wet things. It's difficult for boys, I would imagine it's even harder for girls. And the thing is, well, maybe it's just me, but I find that moment where you're dropping your wet, you know, swimming shorts, and then you're grabbing your dry underpants, and at that moment my big toe always goes massive. It goes like about that large because my underpants always hook on my toe. My towel is going everywhere. It's horrible. I'm flashing more than a lighthouse in a storm. And my friend Adrian, who's really bossy, he said, "Look, I've got to get changed. I want you to..." I can't believe he did this, but he really did. It was very like this, actually. He said, "Form a circle around me, facing outwards." So we're like, yeah, right. So the moment he's got the towel around him and his underpants are caught on his big toe, we all charge in, pull his towel away. And so after this, Adrian is out to get me. And I decide, there is no way I'm getting undressed in front of these people. I'm going to go and find a restroom, a bathroom to get changed in. Has anyone here ever been in a French restroom before? Yeah. They're generally just disgusting. This is not a racist comment, but they're just gross. I don't know what those bathrooms there are like, but
gross.
They're gross too. Okay, so I'm not looking forward to the experience, but I'm scared of being forced to be naked in front of my friends in the middle of Switzerland. So I go back to the car, which is parked in a multi-story car park below ground level, and I get my dry clothes out of the car and I follow the signs to Les Toilettes. And the signs take me to some elevator doors. I realize the bathroom's obviously on a different level. I press the button. I'm not looking forward to the dirty French toilets. The doors open in front of me, this elevator, and it's clean and it's warm and it's empty, and there's a nice little piece of carpet on the ground and it's shiny. And do you ever do things where like your brain is moving slower than your body? Your brain is going, "What are you doing?" And your body's just doing something. And so I step, this is totally true, that's the really sad thing. I stepped into the elevator, and the moment that the doors shut behind me, I found myself pulling down my wet swimming trunks and grabbing my dry underpants, and the elevator's starting to move by this stage, and they've just got caught on my big toe. I'm jumping around, naked as the day I was born, in this elevator, when the whole thing went light, and I realized it was a glass elevator. absolutely true. And it was the centerpiece of a shopping mall. And there's all these French housewives wandering around looking up at the naked English guy going, oh, la, la. So I didn't get arrested, amazing. You know, the thing is, if you'd been there with me and I was about to get in the elevator, you'd have said something to me like, Pete, the elevator is made of glass. Just stop and look and you'll see. Glass is see-through. This is a really bad place to get naked. You'd given me some kind of basic information like that, and I'd have said, that's a really intelligent comment. Thank you for that advice. But unfortunately, I was panicked. I wasn't thinking straight, and I did something really stupid. Times like this, when we get together and, you know, we spend time with one another, we do a lot of fun stuff, we think about God, we make new friendships, these are really great opportunities to actually stop and think for a second about where am I heading, what am I doing, what do I really believe about God, what's going right, what's going wrong in my life. And it's important to have those times. And I don't know about you, but I often find Christianity gets really complicated. It's like there's always something else you've got to learn, something else you've got to understand, some book you're supposed to be reading, some new worship leader you're meant to memorize the lyrics to, some new t-shirt you're meant to be wearing, some new conference you're meant to be going. And after a while, you're just kind of like, look, just make it simple for me. So I'm going to make it incredibly simple for you from one of my favorite bits of the Bible. If you've ever wondered what God's will is for your life, I'm about to tell you, okay? That's a pretty good deal. I'm about to tell you God's will for your life. Just do a little drum roll on your thighs, please. That's good. Don't hurt yourself. Okay. Okay, this is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We're going to read 16 to 18. It's really short, so concentrate. This is what the Apostle Paul says. You can stop hitting yourself. If you want to keep hitting yourself, you can, but you just don't have to. Ready? This is what the Apostle Paul says to you if he was standing here now. He's a funny little short guy and his eyebrows met in the middle. Do you know that about the Apostle Paul? There's an early mosaic of him because he didn't have photographs back then. And his eyebrows met in the middle. So either it was just a really bad mosaic and they put like a little black spot in the middle where they shouldn't have done, or it was like everyone knew his eyebrows met. I like to think his eyebrows met in the middle. He had a monobrow, the Apostle Paul. Who knew that already? Only Brendan. I've lived with that great revelation thus far. This is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 18. This is what the Apostle Paul says to you. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. God's will for you in Christ Jesus is 24/7 joy. Rejoice always. 24/7 prayer. Pray continually, and 24/7 gratitude. Give thanks in all circumstances. Got it? Right, all you have to do is go and do that then, and that's it. It's simple. Let's just think about it a tiny bit more than that though. First of all, I'm not looking at my watch, I've written my notes on my hand. There you go. So I'm not bored, I'm not like busy and meant to be somewhere else. First of all, what does it mean to rejoice always? What does it mean to live with 24/7 joy? Well, here's the deal. I've noticed that Christians sometimes are the least joyful people on earth. And actually, we should be the most joyful because of all the brilliant stuff we've got with God. We were just singing it, weren't we? Oh, how he loves me so. And so there's an extra dimension when we go surfing or when we listen to music or when we throw parties. And I've noticed that suffering is inevitable in life. I'm really sorry about that, but you are all, every single one of you, going to have hard times. If anyone ever said, become a Christian, it'll all be super and easy, they were just lying to you and they've not read their Bibles properly. You're all going to have hard times. I'm really sorry. That's just a fact. Deal with it. But what is not inevitable in your life is good times. And that's why it's really important as a Christian that you go out and make sure that you have as much fun as you possibly can without sinning. Basically, as long as it's not simple, just go and enjoy it and celebrate it, because that stuff's not inevitable. Have you ever seen that Lego Bible website? Anyone ever seen that? They tell all the Bible stories in Lego. It'll rock your universe. You've got to try it. It's great. Well, I saw it. I thought it was quite funny. And I'm part of this global movement of prayer, mission, and justice called 24/7 Prayer. We've got a website that gets 150,000 people every month comes through it. And kind of without thinking, I said, hey, let's link to this Bible Lego website, because it's funny, right? So I did, and then we started getting all these emails from angry Christians. Can you believe it? People saying, what is the significance of the Lego people? I was offended by Adam and Eve being naked Lego people. You know, and I'm thinking, oh no, I've upset all these people, and what am I going to say to them? And I suddenly realized they just need to get a life. And so our response to them was a standard one. We put it up because we thought it was funny. And if you need a Bible verse for that, you need a life. Yeah, love from Pete. That was the response. You know, we're called to rejoice always, and that will make us attractive people. Here, look at this. Tell me this. Why is it hot coals only? Somebody, why? Why is it hot coals only in there? Why can't we put hot coals in the trash can there? Someone.
It'll start a fire.
You start a fire, exactly. You need to keep those apart. That's exactly what Satan wants to do. The moment you get on fire, he wants to keep you apart so you don't create any damage anywhere. But what God wants you to do, I'm not telling you to start little fires, okay? That's bad, it gets you arrested. It's generally not a good thing to do. But I'm talking spiritually here. What God says is, once you get fired up, once you get on fire, he wants to stick you in the dirt, in the mess of the real world, at college, at school, with your friends, people who are abusing themselves, people who are hurting, people who are broken because their parents are divorcing, people who are struggling with their grades, people who are bullied at school. He wants to take you when you get fired up and put you in the trash, put you in the mess, so you can start a bit of a fire. You're not called to be a nice little candle in the corner trying to shine in the darkness. He wants you to get out there, start sparks, and then you pray a lot, so that's like pouring gasoline on the sparks. He's calling you to start fires.